Hello, I'm Graham Horton. Welcome to today's video. Now it's another in the series of my Make It series, where we've been looking at some very simple electronic projects that may help you with some of your photography. Now I've been experimenting with some wireless transmitter receivers, so I could use them with either smartphones or with my mirrorless cameras. I've got a receiver here which normally plugs into the base USB-C socket of a smartphone and you gather the audio that way, but this has got an external 3.5mm connector which you can connect to your mirrorless or DSLR cameras. The trouble is it would need an external supply to power the receiver up. So I thought, well, I've got power banks and I could use those. So I started to mess around with some of my power banks, but I found that the current draw of some of these larger power banks is about 150 milliamps. Now that would mean that I'd have to draw 150 milliamps to enable these to stay on. Now I can understand the reason that the manufacturers put these shutdown circuits in these. So for example, if you're charging your smartphone overnight, once the current draw drops below 150 milliamps, this device will shut down and it prevents you keeping the power on to your smartphone once it's fully charged. So it does protect the battery in the smartphones. They don't like a continuous charging voltage. But it doesn't help us if we got low current devices which would shut down after a short period of time. Now I did devise a circuit some years ago which was the one I call the Keep Alive circuit, and it's just basically a 555 timer. You can see it here, it's basically a 555 timer with an input USB-A and an output USB-A, so you can connect this to your power bank and it will keep the power bank alive by pulsing it at a frequent interval with sufficient current to keep the power bank alive. But my original design was for use with very small power banks, so this has got a very small current draw. So if I plug this into this particular device, you can see it in operation, it's pulsing roughly about every 6 seconds and it's pulsing something like 80 milliamps just to keep the smaller power bank alive, but it's insufficient current draw for these larger power banks. So these time after about 16 seconds. So after that period of time, there's not enough current draw from this device to keep this power bank alive and it shuts down. So I couldn't actually use this device. So it looks as though this one's shut down now. So the LED isn't pulsing anymore. So I could have modified this to apply a larger current draw. It's got a transistor in here, which I could put a smaller resistor in here and increase the current flow when the device turned on. But I thought I'd try and come up with another device which makes it easier to use. This device has got plug-through connectivity, so from the input to the output just on one circuit board, but it meant there was a lot of strain on the board and a lot of strain on the sockets of the power bank. So I thought I'd come up with one with a flying lead. So this is the latest version, which does have a flying lead for the input and the usual USB-A on the output. I've also got a USB-A to USB-C converter that I've made, which just plugs in here if I want to use the USB-C socket. So I've got all events covered. I could have actually just put a USB-C socket on here, or put a USB-A and a USB socket, which I might do in the next iteration of this design. But it's basically the same design as before. So this is the circuit of my new version of this device. It's basically, again, the 555 timer. Because this is a high current draw unit, I don't need to use the lower power CMOS version, so this is a standard 555 timer. You've got the usual configuration, pin 4 and pin 8 are tied to VCC. Ground is connected to ground, of course, and the output drives an LED through the 330 ohm resistor to limit the current through the LED to something like 20 milliamps. And the output current for the pulse is taken by R4, which is a 22 ohm resistor, which gives you something like 160 milliamps of power once this thing switches to ground. The timing is done by this combination of resistors and timing capacitor. So the timing capacitor is 10 microfarad. The charging current, which is done through the series resistors R2 plus R3, so the total of those is 550 kilo-ohms, and that will give me the charging time once the capacitor charges to 2/3 of the rail voltage. The 555 then switches over and discharges U2 through R2. So the discharge, it goes into pin 7. So the discharge time is R2 from the 10 microfarad capacitor. So the timing circuit is 2/3 VCC for the on time and 1/3 VCC for the off time. Now the output from the 555 can be either a current sink or a current source. In this case we're using it as a current sink, so it's taking current from the rail and putting it down to ground when this device switches on. The input and output are tied together for the input from the power bank and the output from the load. So basically all you're doing is putting this circuit in parallel with the power bank, and it's this circuit which pulses down. It gives them that 160 to 180 milliamp pulse, which then keeps the power bank alive. So it's a very, very simple circuit here, done on a piece of error board, standard construction. The chip is in a 8-pin socket to make it easier to install, and just the usual links and jumpers on this bit of error board. Only 4 resistors and a decoupling capacitor for the chip, decoupling capacitor for the 5 volt and rail, and the 10 microfarad time capacitor, and the LED for the indication as when the device is switching. So if we plug this into the power bank, you'll notice that the circuit first of all turns on and you see the LED will be illuminated. So let me plug this into the power bank, switch on the power bank by pushing the power button, and you can see the device turns on. The LED will be on for about 2.5 seconds, then it will turn off, be off for about 3.5 seconds, and then turn back on again. And then that will keep pulsing that 170 milliamp current from the power bank to keep it alive. So with that amount of current, the power bank just doesn't shut down. So with that 160 or 170 milliamp current draw, plus the current from the LED, which is about 20 milliamps, plus the current from your load, will keep the power bank alive and stop it going to sleep. So a very, very simple circuit. All that I need now is put it in a plastic case to protect it, or build it into another project to keep the thing alive. Hope you found that useful. All the circuit diagram and the full explanation of how this circuit does work will be on my Electronics for Photographers page on my photographic blog. I'll put a link to that in the video description below if you wanted to have a look at it and perhaps build one of these devices yourself. If you wanted to make it a USB-C output, then just change the USB-A female socket for a USB-C type. Plenty of them available on Amazon with headers on there, so you can solder them very easily to your printed circuit boards. In the next video, I'm going to look at some power supplies that you can actually use to make your own desktop power supply. A lot of these pre-built modules are very easy to wire. All you need to do is to put them into a small enclosure, and you can use them for charging your lithium-ion batteries, your camera batteries, nickel metal hydride batteries, car batteries, whatever you want. I'll show you how you can set up the constant current and the constant voltage sources with these devices, so they can become very, very useful devices. I'm using one on my multi-purpose lithium ion battery charger. I had about 27 battery chargers, which I've got for all my different cameras, so I've standardized on one power supply, which is going to be one of the Drock power units, and just use a series of adapter plates to enable me to charge whatever lithium ion battery that I need, be it 4 volts or 8.4 volts. So I'll show you that in the next video. So if you want to be kept informed of all the projects that I'll be uploading in this mini series, why not subscribe to the channel and hit the bell notification icon, and you'll be advised when I upload new videos to the channel. If you've not already seen my photographic blog, that link will be in the video description below. And there's also a newsletter. If you want to join that newsletter subscription group, just complete the GDPR form, and then I can send you out the newsletters on a 4-week or 6-week time frame, depending on the amount of time I have to put these together. So until the next video, thanks again for watching. Please do take care, and I hope to see you all very, very soon. Goodbye for now.